I do have a specific plan. I've been a trainer for 45 years and consulting for some of the largest pension funds in the world. So let me just fire it off here. Number one, the unfunded liability is overstated. We are different than the states. We get to keep our income taxes. So when we pay CDRS money out, immediately, a portion of it immediately comes back to the government as taxes. It's CDRS money. It needs to stay in the CDRS. If you get a $3,000 payment, you might pay $1,000 back to the government in payment. That $1,000 is CDRS money that needs to stay in the CDRS. That's $70 million a year in payments. And the EDRS is currently making the government that account for over $1 billion of off money. It does shift the problem from the EDRS to the government, but that's where the problem is. The problem is not in the EDRS, it's funding the government. Number two, the legislature here authorized several years ago $600 million in rent cover over bonds to put the money into the EDRS and never sold them. Okay, and today they can't be sold. But what we can do is contribute those bonds directly into the CDRS to add to the stock and bonds that CDRS already has. That roughly doubles the assets in the CDRS and extends the life substantially. The third thing we can do. I was at the last CDRS meeting at the hospital. It looked like there were 200 people who wanted their money back. They give them the money back. And here's why. If you get in the system, you've been in the system for a number of years, and maybe you put in $50,000, and you decide you want your money back, you don't want to take the risk, you don't like what you see. If we give you your $50,000 back, we are saving the system $100,000. The government matches roughly 2-1 with the employee deficit. The unfunded liability has two components. It's the amount the employee put in plus what the government is supposed to put in, which it hasn't. And so, if the government gives you your $50,000 back, it saves $150,000. The liability goes down by $150,000, not just your $50,000. So, yes, it loses the $50,000, but the amount of others goes down okay, by the additional money. So, the last thing the GRS can do, which is smaller, but it's still something, is to buy the delinquent property taxes from the government. This is particularly important for some place like St. John, where you have people with delinquent property taxes being forced out of their homes. When the GRS closes, it likes to keep them for a long period of time. And that's what we're saying. I believe I do have a solution. I discussed it with Mr. Bush on the radio a few weeks ago. Surprisingly, that makes sense, and it's going to go back and run the numbers. I haven't heard from him. You've heard some things about cuts and benefits and increases in contributions. I'm talking about no cuts and benefits and no increases in contributions. Just a quick word on the Gasoline and Excise Tax. I was just dealing with that on Christmas, and there is no such thing. Okay, gasoline version for the U.S. tax free. And here's okay. The government has. It's in the government now, the GRS is the government. You can shift things back and forth within the government. It doesn't increase the total amount of money. It doesn't generate any money that's not already there. It's just moving things between one pocket and another pocket, and somehow, helping out to create more of that money. Okay, so nothing is gained overall by the government, by any of those maneuvers between government agents. Okay, so we contribute the rent cover of the bonds and the income off of those and the not taking CDRS money for income tax, but we don't have the fund to use it fund of course, and it failed and does work to solve a problem. So I want to just get back to the idea of CDRS investments. By buying delinquent property taxes, they pay 8%, but they improve it 8%. The CDRS needs long-term investments, and so they will never throw anyone out of their house to get the money. Just quickly for information, I owned a bank and was a director for 25 years, and I owned an insurance company as a director for 5 years. So, anyway, you're going to hear recurring theme from me. Guys, we get to keep our own income taxes. It's a mirror tax code, and there are ways we can use that in our favor. And if you've got 3 hours, I'll go into all of them. But the first one I'm going to jump on is. It works like this. You look at a team like the Spurs that has a payroll of $115 million a year, like all the NBA teams. and they're paying approximately $50 million a year in federal income taxes to Washington. That's $1 million a week, approximately. Okay? And if they came down here to train, they would be working here. And if you're working here and earning your money here and paying your taxes to Washington, that is our money. They will transfer it to us with the correct paperwork being filled out. Okay, so that means if we get the spurs to train here, we get $1 million a week. If they come down to a 12-week training period, we get $12 million. Knowing that, we can then find somebody who's connected to the spurs, say, anybody paying the money? And we can talk to each other and say, look, if you can come down here and train and for 12 weeks, we have $12 million we're going to get from the federal government that we can turn over to you to build your sports facility. And have a wonderful place to train, a world-class place to train. And if it's a five-year contract to come down here, you're talking about $60 million to do this. Right? And so now we have a massive competitive advantage because we get to keep our own income taxes. It gives us bargaining tool to use to get these kinds of businesses into the Virgin Islands. And this can be used on many, many levels. It works for matching funds also. So if there's a $100 million project available that requires $10 million in matching funds, okay, we can look at this and say, if we spend $100 million and pay $70 million in wages and salaries down here, we are going to get $20 million in income taxes. And then we can go to the matching funds, and the other $10 million would go to the treasury. We can go to a bank and we can tie the two together. You lend us the $10 million for the matching funds, we'll securitize the arrangement for that. As people get paid, the withholding goes to you to pay your loan back.
You're the only one to rebuttal.
For me, the children come first. Our biggest problem is that we took away a perfectly good stadium from our children that we're now squabbling about. So, how do we bring in these hundreds of millions of dollars? We know now, after a few debates, that Lion King did a big no no. And so, what I'm proposing at this point is that as government, I will go to New York with my new attorney general, my tremendous work, Trump. And we will have a friendly chat with his new partners. And they don't want to be known as having done business that way. They don't go into governments. They don't inspire with senior officials to describe the way to say it to go. They want that much $20 billion responsible company. But look, we're here, we all want to work together, we want to be fired, we want the position. How about just putting the tax rate back up to 17.5% from 12, and the SEC doesn't need to know about anything that happened down there. Okay, and those kinds of friendly talks can result in getting back to where we were under the 2015 agreement. That's the goal. Okay, number one, whoever becomes governor, I would strongly recommend that you build the new hospital first before you knock the old one down. Okay, so, you got to cut the structural thing. So, healthcare, you're going to hear the same recurring theme to keep our own income taxes. So, we're going to explain by example. We have a hospital that bills $10 million to an insurance company. On behalf of the patients, it pays the hospital employees $10 million. Now there's no money left for Band-Aids, Wapa Girls, PC air conditioning in the operating room. Not so fast. When it pays the employees $10 million, $3 million goes to the government, approximately. That's income tax. We get to keep our income taxes. The hospital is part of the government, it's a public hospital, and so that hospital was only $7 million, and there would have been $3 million left over if they hadn't given that money back to the general fund as income taxes. And so, and then they could have paid the Wapa bill and everything else and been self-sufficient and would be looked at as a problem. The hospital is losing money. But if you look at how much money the hospital is contributing to the general fund out of the wages and salaries, which are much higher than that, it's not so bad. Now, number two, we've got satellites around the hospital, such as radiation and we've got all kinds of doctor's offices. And these people make millions of dollars. But in the States, they need to bring those into the hospital so the hospital can recapture those dollars. But here, We can see income taxes that all those people pay. So we need to encourage those, because we're going to lose those taxes if we bring them in, and the cost of operating inside the hospital are much higher than the cost of running an operation outside the hospital. So, number one, by recognizing the real way to account for the hospital, which is the way every agency in the world does, the World Bank is always on a net basis for government, we can see that the medical center is extremely profitable, and that the path to the future is to expand the satellites, we bring in clinics that have long-term patients that are there for more than a year, like a bone marrow transplant, we get to keep the income taxes of the patients. This is a huge bonus. You get some very, very wealthy payments into it more than a year. So I'll get into this more later. Thank you. So a couple of things quickly. Does anybody really think new hospitals are going to make healthcare a whole lot better? Okay. It's got to happen. But it's a very good problem, I think. Other things have to change as well. New schools. We've got my parents, we've got new schools, but we're going to go from the bottom to the top of education. No. It's a major problem. It's not just the buildings. It's like your father gives you a new car, which is nice, but if you don't have gas money, you can't afford it, you don't have a drive. It's not going to work. It's not going to help you. You just have to look at it. We do have an expert. Don't imagine if anybody has a big deal of experts in the so we don't give an expert. I totally agree with Brian. We need larger pools, get more people into the pools, bring the cost down. And yes, federal funding went up. It went up for not such a good reason. It went up because I believe they reevaluated and determined we had a whole lot more desperate people than they thought because the cost of living was so high here. So they adjusted for a higher cost of living, realized that that was not what we thought, and we had to get more funding that way. I'd rather see the economy grow and then increase income double and get less than our funding. Thank you very much for your time. I like it. Yes. Yes. We have a massive competitive advantage to get with them. We need to pay all the income taxes. They pay a large amount of income taxes, millions and millions of dollars, and we can then use those to support their infrastructure. And then we can attract these people to that can give us an enormous competitive advantage over the states. So we need to way back use this competitive advantage to get those kinds of businesses working. Now, I think, in fact, and I hear Albert say he didn't know, all of us were all learning a lot for the first time by listening to the governor. This information is not available, and I appreciate hearing it. Anyway, I talked before about the management and the finance problem, and they've all described the management issues, but let's not forget the finance problem. $220 million came from the refinery sale, which disappeared into operating expenses. Nothing went in place wrong. It disappeared without paying people and operating expenses. And every possible reserve we had was created for operating expenses, but nothing to show for. So when we hit the day before the storm, we had something like, the number is correct, $60 million in debt, and maybe a day or two cash on hand. And the government was stuck with that bill of $150 million. So there's no way you can be prepared to do all these things you want to do if you can't pay for anything. So, what we're looking at now is the same thing. Okay, we've had what almost looks like a scorched earth policy. Like we're not only shoots, but just burn everything so that next people coming through have nothing left. So, right now, we're looking at structural deficit in our office. Some of the senators are spending $200 million. Who knows? Okay, we're looking at $150 million unpaid vendors. We're looking at $40 million unpaid water bills. We're unpaid for the unfunded liability for the GDRS. And then, we managed to get $1 million, and oh, we have money for the whole thing. Sure, and anything else. Okay, so, what I'm saying is, I'm ready to step in and do the things to make the serious money we do to bring in, and not from taxing everybody on the same time, where some guys you know, put some of the highlights out of the phone ahead of Bill and try and cross out that. Our government has always taxed the people who have nothing. Every tax I've seen passed in the last 15 years has been going after the people who have nothing. It's the most aggressive tax structure I've ever seen. And I don't believe nobody's going to come after this thing. Some of the ways we can bring in the serious money that we need, we can bring in the right taxing charge, and we can get ourselves into prosperity and prosperity.
Okay, so look, you know, public tax.
Who's fought against me for political purposes in a public forum?
Is a very serious infraction.
Now, you can tell me that you know your attorney general is not going to do anything about it. That's not what I'm saying. If I want to disclose my taxes, I can do that. That's part of it. But somebody who has access to confidential information using it, like that, is well over the line. Second of all, I will have the Attorney General appointed by the judiciary. We are in a state of severe financial emergency right now. And if anybody thinks that we need to take the list of the ones who can get us out. Well, the front state of the team is number, lucky number 7 on the ballot. We're always lucky number 7. We will get to the tax refund. We will always tell the truth. We will always obey the law. We will always be entirely transparent, like I've been my whole life, driving $30 billion in assets every day to disclose to everyone. It's the only way I know. We will not let you down. So, both of lucky number 7 on November 6th and on November 7th, you will see 6 12 new government interviews up as well on D-Day. Thank you.